like the typical shonen protagonist. Oh my god, look at how big her is. Hi friends, welcome back to my channel. My name is Aina and I'm an oncology pharmacist. So many of you specifically asked me to react to Cells at Work episode 3. This episode is called and boy, do I have a lot of experience with influenza. Giving out drugs to treat it, giving out vaccines to prevent it, and getting it myself. Can't wait to watch it together with you and see what the show has to say about influenza.
Ooh,
scary. Okay, this is like a prison section of the cell. All the windows and doors are barred. Ah, it's a naive cell. Okay, when we use the term naive cell, we can use it to describe either T cell or B cell. But judging by the outfit, I bet this one is a naive T cell. I can totally relate to this. There was one Sunday I was working in the hospital by myself. I was the only pharmacist in the entire hospital that day. The floor that my office was on was actually empty. There was no patients and no other staff. And as I came out of the elevator, I see these massive splatters of blood just on the floor. And I was immediately spooked. Like, where did the blood come from? There wasn't supposed to be anyone there on a Sunday. Oh! So T cells are a part of the adaptive immune system. In my episode 1 Cells at Work reaction, I talked about the difference between the innate versus the adaptive immune system in our body. So going back to when this naive T cell was a baby, T cells are lymphocytes which are made in the bone marrow. After they were made, they move to the thymus. Thymus is like this small gland in our upper chest and it's a part of the lymphatic system. So these T cell babies move to the thymus where they grow up and they become mature T cells. But at this point, they're still naive. They're called naive because at this point, they haven't seen any foreign objects. So from the show, there's a lot of images of sewers and liquids and sort of barred buildings. So this is definitely a representation of the lymphatic system because that's where drainage happens in our body. So this naive T cell is patrolling the area, basically waiting to be activated by the first antigen that is presented to him. I always thought the word naive is really funny to use in medicine. It just means that it's never encountered before. Like, for example, opioid naive means someone who's never used opioids before. Ooh, this is how exactly neutrophils leave the bloodstream and enter the tissue. The fact that he lost one shoe is so funny. I think it might be the show trying to portray that when white blood cells squeeze through the wall, they actually get deformed. Remember in previous episodes, every time the neutrophil senses something, the little radar on his hat starts to beep and light up and then he's immediately drawn to the site of infection? So that's called chemotaxis. Then they literally roll along the blood vessel until they find the site, and then they physically squeeze through the endothelial cells of the blood vessel and they come to the site of infection. Oh, and then he puts the shoe back on to say that the neutrophil returned to its original shape. Ooh. Who is this? Oh yeah, a macrophage. Right, you guys told me in episode 1 they're in the maid outfits because they're seen as the cleanup crew in the body. Very fitting character design. Oh, right. I remember some of you commented that when the macrophage fights and she spins around in a circle and her skirt goes out, it makes her look like this round shape, and it actually reflects what macrophages in real life look like when they're fighting an infection. Here's a side-by-side comparison. Oh my god, look at how big her cleaver is. Oh my god, is the neutrophil feeling self-conscious about his small blade and he's like hiding it behind his back? Well, they have different mechanisms of attack, right? Macrophages engulf the entire cell to destroy it, but neutrophils work differently. So don't worry, neutrophil, there's nothing you need to feel ashamed about. Look at the naive T cell beside you. He's even more useless.
B型のウイルスね。こちらマクロファージです。
This is actually a more rare type of influenza, type B. The most common is influenza type A. Influenza type A is usually the more aggressive and severe type, and it's usually the one causing a lot of pandemics. For example, the Spanish flu was type A H1N1. The 2009 swine flu, that was also type A H1N1/09. So typically, worldwide, there are these four types of flus that are the most common. The two type A's, H1N1 and H3N2, and the two type B's, which are called Victoria and Yamagata. Very weird naming system. Type A name sounds super scientific with letters and numbers, and type B just sounds like last names. Anyone know how they named this? So when you get a flu shot, the good ones actually cover all four types of these common influenzas. I've never counted, but usually during flu season, I think I would give like at least 1,000 flu shots to people. And the best compliments that I get is, "What? It's done already? I didn't feel a single thing." That's when you know you did a good job. The reason why the macrophage is shown here playing with the virus, looking kind of gross, is because macrophages are the ones that are actually presenting the antigen to other types of cells. So this way, other parts of the immune system, like the T cells, B cells, and everyone else, can actually see that the macrophage is like holding this flag, basically telling the whole body that, hey, we've been infected by influenza type B. Oh god. He's actually like the typical shonen protagonist. Starts off as this underdog, has a naive view of the world, unsure of himself, weak, and he gets clowned down by his peers and senpais. But if I know shonen, I'm expecting him to level up and glow up and become a new man. Why is the memory book looking so cute? Okay, so if there are memory T cells present in the body when the infection happens, that means this is not the first time this body has been infected by influenza type B. Why? Because the very first time our body gets infected by a virus or a pathogen or a bacteria, our bodies will produce cytotoxic T cells, which will actively kill the infection, but it will also produce memory T cells, which can actually live up to your whole lifetime. Then the second time your body gets infected, it will not take as long to develop an immune response because the memory T cells are already living in your body. And that's exactly how vaccines work. When we give a vaccine to a patient, we're actually introducing the antigen into the body. Although, of course, it's a weakened form of the antigen. Either the bacteria is dead or inactivated, so you're not gonna get as sick from a vaccine. But you know how some people usually have 1 or 2 days of flu-like symptoms after getting a vaccine? Yeah, that's because your body is actually developing a real immune response to this vaccine. And by doing that, it will produce these memory T cells that will live in your body for a very, very, very long time. And then the next time when a real infection happens, your body can recognize it right away and start attacking it with the already produced immune cells in your body. Ah, here we go. The dendritic cell. He's kind of like the Gandalf of the immune system.
I didn't think it would end this way.
End? No, the journey doesn't end here.
So, in real life, the dendritic cells actually hang on to the pathogen molecules, and they travel down to the lymph nodes and they present these molecules to the naive T cells. This process, like I said in the beginning, is called T cell activation. After this activation process, the T cell now has learned to recognize this specific antigen and now can bind to any cells that are present with this antigen. But it's very specific. It can only recognize one thing. Isn't that kind of like Gandalf presenting the ring to Frodo, teaching him everything that he has to know about the ring? But in the end, it's Frodo's battle and it's up to him to fight. That's really funny. This is like the training arc in all the shonen anime, isn't it? Whoa, 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 what is happening? He's activating. Oh.
僕は過去の弱い自分を克服し活性化して帰ってきました。
That's so funny. Holy crap. He's so buff. He's even bigger than all his senpais. This is an insane glow up. Also, have you guys noticed the weapon choice here? So in the beginning, we saw the macrophage using this big cleaver, the neutrophils using a small blade, and the T cells, they go bare hands. They just use their punches to punch the infected cells. And I think there's a reason behind that too. So once the T cell recognizes an infected cell and it binds to it, it will then release this protein called perforin, which literally punches a hole through the cell membrane of the cell. And then they release this other enzyme called the granzyme to enter the infected cell and tell the cells to go through apoptosis, which is programmed cell death. So I think it's pretty cool that this show uses punches from the T cells instead of using a weapon to kill the infected cells. That's like Agent Smith from The Matrix. Pshh. Oh, there's more?
Oi, oi, また新しいのが入ってきたっぽいぞ。
Wait, what? A
型インフルエンザ。
Oh, oh.
A 型は内部でも A 型が多く。
What, so right after we've cleared influenza type B, we get infected by influenza type A? Who is this person? Maybe they also work in a hospital as healthcare workers and get sick all the time. It's very clever that this show shows that this infected cell by influenza type A now can't be killed by that T cell. Every single unique T cells or B cells can only recognize one type of antigen. So when a new infection happens, our bodies actually have to make more unique cells to target these new infected cells. But if we can't rely on our own immune system to fight off influenza, did you guys actually know there's a prescription drug we can give to patients when they get really sick from the flu? It's an antiviral medication called Tamiflu, or the generic name is called oseltamivir, and we reserve it for people who are really, really sick, either the really elderly or the really young kids who maybe have a weakened or don't have a proper immune system to fight off these infections. Of course, also reserved for people with immunodeficiencies, like primary immunodeficiencies, or those who are on chemotherapy and their immune system are basically being killed by the chemotherapy. It's kind of pricey even in Canada. I think a course of treatment is around $50. I remember there's one year in Canada actually we had a really, really bad flu season and we actually had a lot of death from the flu. And I remember the doctors were prescribing a lot of Tamiflu for our really, really sick flu patients, and I remember giving a lot of them. None of what we just saw and what I talked about would be true if someone didn't have a proper immune system. Either they're born with an immunodeficiency, or they're now immunocompromised from certain drugs like chemotherapy. I made a video talking about primary immunodeficiency in a VTuber called Iron Mouse, and I talked a lot about how infections and vaccines would work in someone's body like hers, so I'll put that link right here. You can watch that right after this video. This was a super fun episode. Thanks for everyone who recommended. Please make sure to give it a thumbs up if you like this video and subscribe for more contents like this. I'll see you in the next one. Bye!